Hello, everyone, and welcome to the RunIowa podcast. This is Rob Lindquist.
And this is Dave Kading.
And this is episode 56, and we're actually live here right now, recording at the Marriott in Des Moines, and we're here at the Capitol Striders dinner. And hi, how are you?
Hi, I'm Sarah Schwendinger.
Hi, Sarah. And Sarah is a board member for Capitol Striders, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Awesome.
Whew, I'm one for one.
Yes.
All right. And so today we're just kind of doing, I better not lean on that table, just kind of a round table. We're just kind of seeing the vibe and what's going on in the Des Moines scene and that kind of thing and all the people coming in. And so we just have some random weird questions that we might ask, and it might not be weird at all. But the first thing I guess I wanted to ask, if you don't mind, we're completely throwing this on you, so thank you.
Sure.
Beginning runners, okay?
Yes.
Warm up and cool down seems to always be an issue.
Yes.
Should there be a decent warm up and cool down for a beginning runner? And if so, what kind of tips or what should that be if somebody's just getting out there maybe for their first run in the spring?
Well, I would say that honestly, this is an issue for experienced runners too.
Absolutely.
Because we just want to get to it.
Absolutely.
One of my biggest downfalls is I don't do enough of a warm up.
Right.
Because I want to get out there and get my run done.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I would say yes, for any runner, you need a good cool down or warm up and a cool down.
Sure.
My suggestion is you can do perhaps 10 minutes of just easy running.
Sure.
To get started, and then do some easy stretches.
So, you know, and you say that, and I'm totally going to interrupt here. When I think of warm up, I think, you know, down on my knees and stretching this way and that way, which I hear is awful for you.
Correct.
And so what I've started doing is kind of like you said, I jog for 10 minutes or something, or
yes.
I do a couple quick swings of my legs, and then I use that first mile as a warm up.
Right.
Is that okay for beginning runners?
Yes, and the worst thing to do is to try to stretch a cold muscle.
Right.
So, yes. That's absolutely the right thing to do. You want
awesome.
To get those muscles activated
right.
and warmed up so that they're more pliable. So that when you stretch them, you don't run the risk of pulling something,
right.
stretching
sure.
too far. So absolutely, that is definitely the way to go.
Awesome. It's one of those, I've been so lucky.
He only asked that because he wants to look like he's smart.
Right. Well, absolutely. And I'm looking for a piece of wood right now because I haven't had an injury yet. But I think warming up is probably not as big of an issue for me as cooling down. Usually what I end up doing is I'm done with my run. Dave and I get back to our cars. I hop in the car and I go get my kids.
Right.
How important is a cool down for somebody?
Important.
Maybe to help me keep injuries away.
Yes. So conversely, so you want to get ready for your run by warming up.
Right.
So what we want to do is then get the body basically rested and done after the run is over with.
Sure.
So a lot of times, you know, you may be drinking some water, getting a snack or something after you're done running.
Right.
Spend at least those few minutes while you're doing those things doing some easy stretching.
Sure.
If you're not a huge stretching person, my biggest friend for my cool down is my foam roller.
Right.
So if you're not
I have one. I don't know how to use it, but I have one.
There are many videos on YouTube.
Right. Exactly.
So either way, so I do a combination of rolling and stretching afterward, but you don't have to spend oodles of time.
Sure.
Honestly, if you just did 5 minutes
right.
of easy rolling and stretching when you're finished, while you're doing, like I said, getting something to drink, maybe having a piece of fruit or whatever it is,
right.
you're getting a bagel, whatever, after your run, just spend that amount of time you would spend eating or drinking.
Right.
Stretching.
Right.
There we go.
That's awesome.
That's as easy as that.
That's how I do it. Because
right.
if you're going to be doing something anyway during that time, just add something to it.
Sure.
Add a stretching to
awesome.
it.
Awesome. Awesome. So my question, I have two questions for you.
Okay.
Of course he does. He has
I always, you know, get mine in there. First of all, I'm going to ask your medal. Everybody's wearing a race medal today.
Yes.
So what's your race medal? Tell us a little about the race and your medal here.
Okay, so my race is from 2014, and it's the Milwaukee Lakefront Marathon medal.
Awesome.
So I'm originally from Wisconsin.
Cool.
Milwaukee area. So in 2014, I actually ran this with a slight injury.
Okay.
And I wore this medal tonight, number one, because, well, it's cool.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah,
it's
yes,
a thing of swings yep. in the middle, right?
Right?
And my father, who was a runner with me for over 20 years. This was the last race that he saw me finish because he actually passed away 6 months ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
While out on a run.
Really?
Terrible.
Yes. And so this is special to me because that was the last race that my dad was at the finish line to see me run.
Sure, that's great. That's great.
It means a lot.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. And so my second one is, and maybe you kind of answered this, so out of all the running that you've done and places that you've gone and you've run with your father for, like you said, 20 years, what would be the place, that the run that you would recommend to somebody saying, hey, this is the have to? Yeah, I have to go do this. Bucket lister.
Bucket list run. Okay, I'm wearing the shirt. Cherry Blossom 10-miler, Washington, D.C.
All right.
It's now a lottery race.
Right.
But, first of all, you start and finish by the Washington Monument.
Awesome.
And you get to run by the Jefferson Memorial and amongst all the cherry blossom trees.
Sweet.
At the height of spring.
Right.
So, and a 10-mile is somewhat of a unique distance.
Right.
Right? We have 5Ks, 10Ks, halves,
right,
and marathons, but you don't always find a 10-mile
right,
race.
Right, absolutely.
We actually have one. Capital Striders has one here in Des Moines.
Hey,
in
there
September.
We go.
Just
yes.
A little plug
hey,
there.
Absolutely.
But I would say this definitely is a bucket list for anybody. It's beautiful. It's been run for over, I believe, over 30 years now, so
that's
they really
cool.
know what they're doing. They get some of the best runners actually
sure.
in the world for
right.
that race.
I bet.
And it's really a race for everybody. Spectators are great. It's well organized. A great expo.
Cool.
So
oh,
that
awesome.
Would be my recommendation.
Yeah, that's
of,
so,
I mean,
that's
there's so
cool.
many. But
yeah, sure. No doubt. No doubt.
Well, Sarah, we appreciate it.
Thank
and
you.
If you happen to see anybody else, yes, yes. shuffle them
I will
our
send
way.
Them your way.
And just shame them this way.
You
don't
get right. You bet. You bet.
Thank
well,
you, Sarah.
You
we appreciate
night.
It.
Thank you.
Cool. So, as you
yeah.
can tell, we are here rocking at the Capital
yes.
Striders event. And come on over if
right.
you'd like.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right.
Trevor, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good. I'm glad everybody's wearing name tags.
Yeah,
I'm Rob, this is Dave.
Nice to meet you.
Terry, how are you?
Nice
Oops.
To meet you.
Nice to meet you. So we're with RunIowa, and we're just kind of basically talking about anything you guys want to talk about as it goes to running or Capital Striders or anything like that. If you don't have anything you want to talk about, I have questions.
You bet.
But if we want, we can also start. Hi, you want to come on in? Okay, let's
right.
do this. You hand your
I'm
microphone that way.
Over.
We have this all planned out, too.
There we go.
We actually have something we could talk about.
Awesome.
All right, and so now I'm ready. All right, what do you have for us?
Are you guys familiar with Relay Iowa?
Absolutely.
Yes, we are.
Have you guys done it?
No, we have not.
Okay, well, we've done it, and I've done it, I think, three times, but it's
okay.
a good cause. So it's if people aren't familiar with the Relay, it's an awesome event. It goes to support an orphanage in South Africa. So
right.
it's for a really great cause, and it's growing every year.
Yeah, that's great. Who did we talk to somebody?
We did 2 weeks ago.
Right. Yeah, I can't keep
I can tell you.
Straight. Right. I listen, I talk, and that's about it. So tell us a little about your team. You've done it, you said, now three times, and,
yep.
and you're going to do it again, I'm sure.
Maybe. This
maybe.
Year, I don't know if I'm going to make it this year or not, but we were there second year it ran, second or third year,
yep.
and our team was called Slowpokes.
You're right.
And
I got him into it, so I originally registered for it. And
yeah, so I heard a bunch of our friends were talking about doing it, and then all of a sudden it grew into this big team. So
yeah,
we,
awesome.
We ran it the first year, and then we split into two teams the second
okay.
year, so we had one faster team and one slower team,
right.
so we did it with eight people the second time. Which I think averaged, I think we each had to do about 45 miles
that,
over the 50 hours.
Right.
Oh boy.
And it was a great time.
I
think there were probably 40 teams or so now.
Right, yep.
First time we did it was about a dozen. So
yeah,
it's really growing.
Right. So when you did this, your relay, and you ran with them also? You're just hanging out with us.
All
right.
That's
right.
Hey.
Sweet. So for somebody who's looking to do a relay, because we've done the market-to-market, Rob's done the Iowa and the Nebraska. I've done that Nebraska one, I think, four times or something like that. This is a little bigger in Denver than doing a one-day 79-mile one. I mean, it's the longest relay race in the country, if
yep.
not in the world.
There's one in China that's longer.
Yeah,
that's geez,
right.
But this one's like 300.
I think they call
miles.
Those... concentration marches or something. I don't think that's really a relay race.
Voluntary relay.
Right. Yeah. So anyway, for somebody who's looking to do it, since you guys have run it, you know, there's a big intimidation factor in running something like that. You know, you look at the map of Iowa. First of all, you go to the northern part and it's not really that flat. So there's some hills to run. What would be a tip for somebody who's like, I really like to do it, but you know, I'm not really a runner. I like to go out recreationally and run. What would be a big tip to kind of get somebody out there who's a little intimidated to do something like that?
Well, the cool thing about Relay Iowa, I would say, is if you compare it to other relays out there like Ragnar and things like that, those
right.
have set leg lengths you have
right.
to do. Relay Iowa is very loose, and your team gets to decide what lengths you want to do.
Cool.
So you can have stronger and weaker runners on the team if you want. You can also break it up into 2 mile segments if you'd rather do it that way. So that allows a lot of flexibility because you go to like a Ragnar or something, they're going to tell you this leg is 12 miles. So that's a big advantage to Relay Iowa. But I think the big challenge you have to be aware of is staying loose. I mean, it's a lot about stretching, a lot about recovery because you're going to have multiple legs.
Right.
And sleep deprivation
right.
is half the fun.
Yeah, I hear that. So, because this is great because we had, forgive me, you know, Rob's the smart guy who's going to say his name.
Right.
He remembers everybody who's been on our show. No, I guess not.
I will in a minute.
Anyway, talking about it. So when you're running these legs and you're doing it over a whole weekend, you're running two vehicles, right? That's kind of thing. What is the downtime? I mean, is somebody driving out ahead and you're setting up tents and sleeping in tents, or how did that work out?
Well, with our group, they drive ahead, whoever wasn't running, to the next town, and you would sleep wherever.
Right.
We slept in the city parks. We slept in the vans. We slept anywhere, picnic tables.
Gym.
So,
sure. Sometimes the school's holding
right.
up.
That's cool.
Yeah, so you just sleep whenever you can, which the first day it's like impossible to sleep. You're just like, I want to go.
Right, too jacked up.
But yeah, you just sleep whenever. I think over the whole weekend I got 2 hours sleep total, 19 miles in two hours. And it's just crazy, but
I
did it.
By the third year, I've gotten way better at getting sleep because you settle down mentally.
Right, sure.
You get used to the idea because when you first do it, it's hard to sleep because you're thinking about, okay, I'm going to have to go run again in 2 hours. And you're nervous about it. But then after you've done it a few times, you get the hang of it. But your longest layover is going to be maybe 6 hours total between runs. It's honestly not as bad as it sounds.
Right.
It is really intimidating up front.
Right.
But if you really focus on eating the right stuff,
and
a lot of foam rollers and
you
sticks
bet.
And that kind of stuff.
And if everybody's like laid back and not uptight over everything, that makes it so much more fun. Because then it's just like, hey, we're just having this party. We're rolling down the road.
Right.
It's great.
Awesome.
I'm back. It's Bill Rain. That's what we talk about.
Bill runs the race.
Yeah, exactly.
He and his family. And that's part of the fun, too, is you get to know he and his brother and his wife, who I think passed away.
She had cancer.
But they would all be out on the round. You'd see them constantly because they are up pretty much the entire race, moving signage and things like that across the route. And it really becomes a community because you see the same teams. It's kind of like Ragbri that way, that you're moving with the same groups across the state. And, you make a lot of new friends on it.
It seems like about 3 years ago, our market-to-market team, I tried to get them to kind of buy into it, and it was when me being the old guy out of the bunch, I can make time to do about anything I want to. These young guys who have little kids, it was like, oh, school's out and we all teach. So, like, it's summer vacation, I get to hang out with my little kids, and I'm like, you don't know what's coming up yet. You're pretty soon you're going to be wishing that you could get out of the house and get away from it.
Well, one of the fun things about that we found with Relay Iowa, just relays in general, too, is our team is assembled with people from all over the country.
Oh, really?
So they all met up through Facebook. So it starts with a couple of people here know each other, and then you figure out there's this giant relay community of people just looking for races.
Sure.
So our team has had people from Florida and Ohio and Indiana, and then since then we've gone around the country and done other races
with
them, like the Bourbon Chase in Kentucky and things like that.
I'm in. Sign me up for the Bourbon Chase.
It's awesome.
I have to ask, though, the medals that you guys have. Tell us a little bit about what medals you guys have.
Well, this one is from, it's called Dances with Dirt. And that's a trail ultra in Wisconsin, up by the Wisconsin Dells.
Awesome.
And it goes through Devil's Lake State Park.
Right.
And beautiful views at the halfway point of the half marathon. It's a cliff face overlooking this valley. And you kind of forget about your time because you just want to stand there for a second and look at the view.
Awesome.
So I did that for the first time last summer.
Cool.
And the medal comes with, it's a beer bottle opener.
Right.
So
it's
very handy.
You got to have that.
Yeah. So you just wear it all the time. Then.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just whip out my medal.
Mine is North Face Endurance Challenge Wisconsin, which that was my first half marathon trail race that I had done before. And so, it was another, it's in a Kettle Moraine State Park, another gorgeous, gorgeous venue. And
Dave's a science teacher. He knows all the state parks.
Yes.
You know, yeah.
Yes, you know the geology
and
all that.
I actually just looked at that one for trying to figure out a Wisconsin half.
Oh, yeah, it's great. It's great up there, and they host a great race. So.
Awesome.
Yeah, Dean Karnassus comes every year to the race, and you can actually stand there and chat with him.
Oh, really?
That's awesome.
That's nice.
Cool. Angel, what do you got? You joined us in.
I am probably the least experienced runner in the group. This is only my second half marathon.
Congratulations. Hey, there you go.
But it was the first half where I went sub two. So I was really excited about that, especially coming off of a foot injury.
Yep.
I was just really proud to
awesome.
See that happen. So.
One day I'll get sub three, so we'll see. No, but congratulations.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for joining us. We appreciate it. And when you see us running or when you're passing us at any time, make sure you say hi.
Passing us.
So, and the Relay Iowa we can find online. People, if in case you guys didn't know, on our podcast, we talked to, like I said, Bill Rain, but way back on episode 45. So listeners can go back and listen to that. So
awesome.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Can I take a picture with you guys?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So one thing that we're asking everybody, in case you didn't notice or see, is that everybody was invited to wear a race shirt and a medal that they want to tell a story about, basically.
Right. And I have neither. I don't have a real race shirt. I have our Run Iowa shirt on, and I didn't wear a medal.
Right, so you just blew that all.
Because I'm a geek.
So Angel's going to take our picture, right? Okay, with you, I would assume.
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
So should we just pick this, like,
we can,
selfie style?
We can do it.
Okay.
Let me come this way.
Oh, no, we're going to swing around. There he is.
There you go. Awesome, thank you.
90% of my pictures, my eyes are closed, just so you know. So
that's bad.
It's a bad habit.
Yeah.
So,
thanks, guys.
No problem, thank you. So, as we're talking with medals, I have my medal here. I decided to use my Dirt Devil Racing medal, the half marathon I ran with Nicole in San Diego.
San Diego.
Up a mountain and stuff like that. It was my first real trail run with... let's say a mountain.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm gonna let's move the mics back around.
Right. Yep. There you go.
Thank you, sir. And the next part too is about this event. You know, just the meeting people and the seeing people and all that kind of stuff. And we are, you know, we're enjoying our beverages and we're talking.
Right. Hey, I have a question.
Yeah, absolutely.
No. Do you think any of these are West Siders that are headed home that are in AA that can drive us?
Yes.
Because I'm getting thirsty.
There you go. That's right. And there's nothing wrong with that. Everybody enjoys talking and they enjoy their beverages. And so we appreciate it. But we're going to ask, in case you didn't know, we didn't really have a big introduction.
No.
But what we're going to do is we're just going to invite people up and whoever comes up can come up and talk. And we're just, you know, going to talk to them. And that's going to be our episode.
Yeah. And, you know, this is such a great event that they're putting on this dinner for all the runners here in the Des Moines area or beyond.
Hi.
And we got somebody else coming up who wants to share their story.
All right, Girls on the Run. My wife has told me I need to contact you.
Oh, you know Girls on the Run.
She does.
She does.
And I apologize, I don't. So you're Krista.
I'm Krista, yep.
Thank goodness for your name tag.
Yes, nice to meet you guys.
And so tell us, let's start. Let's tell us about Girls on the Run.
Yeah.
Right,
my wife would be so proud, by the way. So,
are you from the Des Moines area?
We are from Council Bluffs.
Council Bluffs.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So Girls on the Run in Polk County here, we serve kind of just a little bit of central Iowa. And we have about 350 girls at 24 sites this spring coming up. And we just inspire girls in third through fifth grade to be joyful, healthy, and confident. That's kind of our mission.
Sweet.
And we just use running as a means to deliver that message.
Sure, that's great. That's great. Oh, yeah, Rob's got a...
Sorry, I'm getting every selfie too I can. So, why that age group? Why is that important to get them into running
out? Yeah, so... Studies have been found that this age group, that's when they start getting, you know, kind of low self-confidence, self-esteem issues, body issues are coming along.
Right.
You know, they're dealing with bullying in schools and things like that. So we're just trying to meet them where they are. So kind of preventative for some of the younger girls and kind of techniques to work through the issues that they're facing for the kind of the older girls.
Right.
Sure, absolutely.
Awesome. Awesome. All right. Rob and I both being fathers of daughters and both being educators, you know, we kind of see all the whole story. So if I'm a parent and you have a daughter in there, you know, sometimes because we're old enough, I think all of us been through this bullying and all everything that's just, you know, I hate to say the normal, some of it is and some of it isn't, but what would you say or what's your message maybe out for a parent that might hear this and say, yeah, my daughter doesn't, I mean, sometimes you just got to suck it up because we hear a lot of that and it's not always the case. So what would you say to those people, families out there that might have a daughter that needs a little help that they don't know it?
Yeah, so kind of the technique that we tell the girls is we really want them to stand up for themselves. So kind of confront the issue, telling the person who's giving them an issue how they feel and what they would like them to do and like them to stop and how, you know, how they can work together to kind of proceed, you know. So giving them the confidence that they're able to stand up for themselves, or even the confidence just to tell their parents or a teacher or someone that this issue is going on, that they deserve better than them.
I think, you know, with our with the age of technology and stuff, I think one skill that has been lost in our youth or with our youth is being a self-advocate. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't really, it's easy to get on the phone and text somebody saying, frowny face, I'm not happy with you. But actually advocating for your own protection and safety and stuff. Yeah. The kids don't do a very good job of that.
And especially learning that at a young age is super important.
We see a lot of that in the high schools. So if somebody wants to check you out, find out where you are, what they can do to be involved, where can they go?
Girlsontherun.com or .org?
We can edit it. Yeah, there you go.
I'm not for sure which one it is. So go to the international site. So it's an international program based out of Charlotte, North Carolina.
Okay.
And you can go and you can find your council
awesome.
Where it's at.
Awesome. So. And do you guys host events, kind of feel the thing out, or running events or things that people can find out?
Yeah, so we host seasons. So we have a fall season and a spring season. At the conclusion of each season, we do a 5K.
Sweet.
So, and that's where the girls, it's just like an event that we celebration that they've completed the event.
Awesome.
So we always need adult running buddies to run with the girls or volunteers to even, you know, help organize and help, you know, registration process and things like that.
So when is your next event? So for the people who are right here in Iowa and in around the Des Moines area, when's your next big event?
Yep, so our Des Moines, our season's going to start March 21st, and our end of season 5K is Friday, May 27th.
Friday, May 27th.
And I did some double checking. It's girlsontherun.org. There you go.
Oh, awesome.
That's
awesome.
Well, we appreciate you stopping by. That's awesome.
Thank
and my wife will definitely look into it on our west side.
I know there's like an Omaha Council Bluffs.
Right. I think
chapter,
it's a mixed group thing. Yeah.
Super. Yep, so check it out.
Great. Thank you very much. Yep. We appreciate it. Awesome. Nicole was telling me about this, and in the West Side, we have some running groups with elementary kids and stuff like that, too. And just getting those kids involved is super important.
Right.
So while we have a quick break between guests, just so you guys know, if you're listening right now, you can hop on YouTube, and we are actually filming this. We have two cameras here.
Right.
Hi, everybody.
Right.
And one behind Dave as well for the guests, or Dave's
because
back.
Because I've got a real nice ass.
Right, that too. So we can take a look at... We're quiet.
So Brad is actually talking right now. So we're going to take a quick and listen here.
Oh. So it only allowed you to vote for three people. It was actually supposed to allow you to vote for seven.
Oh.
So
there's a board member vote.
Going on. That registered for the dinner, who is a member, will get an email tonight with the correct survey.
Breaking news: Donald Trump just won the nomination.
So,
while they're talking about that, Gary Allen is here. And Gary is going to be speaking. He's out of Maine, and he's a 68-time marathoner.
Yes.
And this is my golf voice.
Yes. He's one of only 30
and he,
people who have run sub-3-hour marathons in 5 decades.
I think it's 4 decades. Was
four?
It five?
Five, I believe.
But we will talk to him at some point in the very near future.
So, I'll holler over at Turtle, our producer, and see if he can Google that up.
So he's going to take that back and tell everybody how awesome we are. So everybody, did everybody get a chance?
And they're talking door prizes and things like that right now. So really cool event for people in the group.
Okay, you get an extra door prize, okay? So you get a total of two. If you printed out the bottom of the email, where's Joyce? I know she did.
Here. I know Dave's looking to get a beer, so we're still recording, and we're just going to let it run. So if you're running right now, you're at about 20 minutes, and we're about to have another beer.
Yes, we are.
Oops, that's my chicken dinner.
That's not going to get you a beer.
So there's that. And so, oh, yeah. Hey, we got a shout out. So hi, everybody. We're recording, not live. All right. So, absolutely. We're going to have random people talking, and it's awesome.
They're going to do like an hour
Or tomorrow. Okay.
Run Iowa podcast.
It's on Podbean. It's on iTunes. Oh, here, I got
mine first.
Ooh. We're talking medals now. Gary has a 1980 New York Marathon medal. And so they're talking about that. What we're going to do right now is we're going to take a break on the podcast so we can get some announcements going here, and we'll come back in just a second on the RunIowa podcast.
Up a conversation with another runner, and what other thing can you do where you can meet complete strangers with a common thread? You trust them,
right?
They trust you.
Yep.
It's an unspoken language. It crosses all gender boundaries.
Right.
It crosses all ethnicities.
Right.
Backgrounds. Everything. Running is sort of, you know, it's the world's largest peaceful movement of people all doing the same thing,
right,
where no one judges anyone.
Right.
It's a wonderful thing.
And I think one of the biggest things that helps that cause is anybody can do it. Well,
yeah,
you know, skill level, you can be an elite runner, you can be brand new to the sport, and yet still have conversations with everybody. And that just seems to be like one of the higher... that's a great way to get involved.
Right.
I agree. A mile is a mile.
Right.
Right.
It's 5,280 feet, and if it takes you 15 minutes or 5 minutes, it's still a darn mile.
Right.
So,
and
you know,
I haven't run a lot of places, but enough, and we've talked to a lot of people and been around. The part that I appreciate the most about runners and just running is, if I show up at the Milwaukee Marathon or I show up at the New York or wherever I'm. It doesn't matter who I run into. The guy could be a sub-5-minute miler, and I can be a 15-minute miler, and he'll still talk to me, like you said, and say, "You're doing a great job." Even though it takes me three times as long to run it,
right,
he still appreciates it, because he knows 26.2 miles is 26.2 miles, and most people won't even think about attempting it, and if you are, you're good with me.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I appreciate.
Yeah, well, I mean... I'm a fairly good friend with John Dunham, and he's the director of the Boston Marathon movie that's coming out, and he also did Spirit of the Marathon.
Right.
And we've had these kind of conversations where, you know, he's very keen on documenting this amazing transformation that happens to people when they become runners.
Right.
And how we all get along, and
right,
nobody judges anyone, and everybody is in it together, and so it's fun to talk about it. It's fun to do it. It's a uplifting, positive crowd, and your skill set is good. When you toe the line, it doesn't.
Right.
No one's thinking, you know, Mev Kiflezgi is better than you, or
right.
I mean, obviously we know he is, but you don't feel that.
Right.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
For our listeners here, we're talking with Gary Allen. He's from Run MDI, the marathon in Maine.
Correct.
And sorry, I'm stuttering here. And we're just kind of, you know, I want to ask you, first of all, we're going to try to get you on the show on your own. But I want to ask you, what was the point in your life where you decided, I'm a runner? Like, how did that happen for you?
Well, my start to running as a lot of your listeners probably did, was inspired by others. I grew up on a small offshore island off the coast of Maine.
Sure.
My family actually settled there in the 1650s.
Awesome.
So they were the original inhabitants, so I'm 12th generation.
Oh, man.
So as a school kid, I wanted to be a hockey player. I wanted to be a Boston Bruin.
Right.
You know, that's Boston down the way.
Right.
But the problem is, you know, I attended a one-room school, and there weren't enough kids to have a hockey team. So I would stick and puck when the ponds froze and practice my dream of becoming a Boston Bruin. And then in 1972, I saw Frank Shorter enter the Olympic Stadium in Munich and win the, you know, that Olympic marathon.
Yeah.
And I was like, wait, you, and I saw them put the medal around his neck, and I said, wait, you can get a medal for running? And so then I changed from wanting to be a hockey player to a runner. I wanted to win the Olympics. And as a kid, you believe, I think you believe you can win the Olympics.
Absolutely.
And there's no reason, I didn't know I couldn't. Right. So I started running, inspired by Frank Shorter. And I'm happy to report I've actually gone for some runs in Maine with Frank Shorter. And,
that's amazing.
And can talk about that maybe when we talk again.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Good teaser.
But Frank, you know, it inspired me, and so I started running, and I didn't think anything of it that the island I live on is only 2 miles long. I was like, so I slowly over the years and now decades would run up and down that island, and I've run over 100,000 lifetime miles now.
That's
and
amazing.
So, you know, I think at some point I was like, wow, to be a really good distance runner, it's going to be kind of hard on this island, but then I think what happened, and I didn't really know it, is it made me incredibly mentally tough to be
sure.
Kind of like
that was exactly what was going through my head. If you're going back and forth, you got to really be with it up here to stay with it.
So I just stayed with it. I kept running over the years, and I broke 3 hours for the first time in order to qualify for Boston in 1978, and you know, and ran it, and you know, and then you know, I just fell in love with it, and so just kept running, and then I cracked 3 hours again in the 80s, you know, and then in the 90s, and then again in the, you know, in the 2000s, and in 2010s. And so my good friend also, Amy Burfoot, who won the Boston Marathon in 1968, started researching people that have broken 3 hours in five consecutive decades, and as it turns out, not many people have, only about 30 in the world.
Wow. That's amazing.
And so, you know, I kind of joked with Amy, and I said, yeah, but I never was fast anyway.
Sure.
So I've just been consistent.
Right.
So I haven't actually slowed down. I've just been consistent.
That's
so
amazing.
Yeah.
That's
so
amazing.
Well, we're going to get into that. That's a great teaser. We got to stop it there, and then we'll get you back on.
Let's talk again.
So, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Let's talk again. And yeah.
Otherwise, we'll keep you here, and they'll not get to hear
us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Thanks, guys. So, I love Iowa. I'm run Iowa.
Absolutely.
And I look forward to listening
yeah.
in.
Cool.
And sharing your shows with people in Maine.
Oh, that would be great.
And around.
Yeah, yeah, we'd love it.
Well, we appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Honestly, I could sit there and talk for hours.
No doubt.
Yeah. Isn't that great?
There's more than one episode of stories going on.
Oh, absolutely.
You know,
and that's the best part. And I hate saying, oh, go away, but we got to get him back.
Yes.
That's so cool. For you listeners and watchers out there, you can see, you know, the crowds have started to dissipate a little bit.
Yep.
And so we'll wrap things up here pretty soon. But such a cool experience for a lot of people just to see different people coming in and out and getting involved in a running group like this or any other running group to help keep you motivated is always something that could be beneficial in many different ways. So, very cool.
Yeah, it's awesome. And it's so cool seeing a community of runners that are getting together to celebrate what they do, you know, celebrate the victories, triumphs, and do that. That's amazing. It's just a cool thing. I that's all I can mutter out right now.
Absolutely. So we're looking at about 6:50 here, local time, as we're doing this. And again, we're going to try to get this out tonight or tomorrow.
Yep.
Depends on when I get home and that kind of thing. But it's a very cool event, and we'll get this out for everybody. We'll try to get Brad on one more time if he gets a chance.
Yeah, he's.
Can do you got a couple minutes or
are
you busy?
I have like 2 minutes.
Okay, he has 2 minutes. Brad, how are you?
I'm good.
Good.
Awesome. Thanks, guys, for
welcome back. You're our first 3-time guest now.
Yes, 3 times.
So, with that being said, what does it take to organize an event like this?
You know, it's a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
It really is. We've been working on it for about 6 weeks. You know, and picking the speaker is such a hard process.
Sure,
you know, and we've had some in the past that have just been amazing.
Sure.
You know, amazing guests. We had Michael Wardian a couple of years ago. We've had the Penguin come speak. you know, we've had a couple of others that, you know, just are just incredible.
Sure.
I think we landed on a good
one. Oh,
we just had like 5 minutes with him, and I said, oh my gosh.
So yeah. He's crazy. Yeah.
Very cool.
It'll be worth listening to. We're
absolutely
excited.
Absolutely.
And then the other thing we want to ask is, where's your medal?
I am actually
wearing my belt buckle.
I'm wearing my buckle.
Yeah.
You can't really see it, but...
Well, people can't see it past those shorts.
Exactly. You know, they look at the shorts, man. Yeah. You'll very rarely see me in long pants. Oh, so, yeah. Like, that's if good. I get a chance to wear shorts, I wear shorts. And I'm rocking the buckle from Rocky Rack.
Right.
And I had to find a $12 belt at Walmart. It took me 3 chances to go Walmart to find a belt. So, yeah.
Nice.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Well,
very cool event. And we're going to wrap things up and come on in and see the events. And
that's going to be great.
Get awesome. The whole thing out. So
can't wait.
We appreciate the invite.
Thank you for the offer.
Yeah, absolutely.
You bet.
So with that being said, Dave, I think that's going to wrap up the show.
Right.
Any last thoughts? People that are watching on the YouTube, you can see I had all sorts of questions and everything ready, but this turned out way better.
This is awesome.
So one thing I wanted to ask you, and I think through our few guests we had here, how is being invested in something like this help somebody?
Oh, geez. Countless ways. I think the first is just like, you know, we talk about it being coaches at school.
Mm-hmm.
If you can get kids involved in something that's not the norm, they're so much more likely to be successful in everything else that they do.
Sure.
And I'm not saying, you know, like, okay, I run, so therefore I'm Warren Buffett.
You are way Warren Buffett, though.
But you do. You kind of, for some people, it's just that it gets them out of their shell. You know, they are become more... less extroverted or less introverted and more extroverted,
right.
You know, and because they meet people, just self-confidence, you go out there and run, and it doesn't, again, we've said it 100 times, it does not matter
right
how fast you run. If you go out there and run a half marathon, you ran a half marathon. You ran the same race that everybody else did, and that's great for people. You see it all the time that somebody gets involved in this, and then when you can join a running group or a club, it's just more, it's affirmation of what you just accomplished. And
sure,
it's such a big deal. At least the benefits, just there's so many to go through. What about you? What do you think?
Just the community thing. And we were talking actually with Lance a little bit ago before we went on air, and just being able to just kind of see everything and be a part of it and talk about trails and talk about different things at different times is always important for everybody on the run. So... very cool to be here. Glad we were invited.
This is fun. This is part of why running is cool. We just happen to get to talk about it.
Right. Well, and we run.
But the bonus is we talk about it, so we get to hook up with people and do this. And it's not because we talk about it necessarily. It's because we're runners, and they're like, hey, you're runners. Come and do this with
right,
us.
Right, yeah,
you
know, absolutely.
That's the common ground.
So, very cool. Again... if you get involved with a group, it doesn't matter which one, whether it be Capital Striders or anybody that's in your local area. Of course, the guys in Dubuque, we know those guys as well. So getting involved with them or on the west side of the state with us, just, you know, get involved with somebody. Right. And that could very much help you with your motivation and things like that.
Right.
And, you know.
We'll have to throw a challenge out to the Dubuque guys to say, we're doing a live one, you know. For the right price, we could be out in Dubuque.
Right, and you know what it costs. You guys, wrote those on YouTube. You
were cheap.
Now. So, yeah. But with that being said, I think that's going to wrap it up for this episode of RunIowa. What do you think?
It's awesome.
Okay, cool. So with that, next week we're going to probably be back to our old ways.
Be back to our normal.
And then we'll get things rolling. So, Dave.
Awesome, yeah. Happy trails.